Good afternoon. Looks like a lot of interesting conversations going on here. The biographies of great men and women sometimes come in three volumes. And this morning we heard from Nicola Brennan about some of the period of time while Professor Francis Omaswa was leading the Uganda Health Services. And this evening we're going to hear at the honorary fellowship ceremony some of the details of Professor Omaswa's career. I've known Professor Omaswa over the last 15 years and have observed how he stewarded the Uganda Health Services through what was probably one of the most exciting periods in terms of health sector reforms in Africa. And Uganda very much led the way for Africa at that time with Francis at the helm. Just looking at his career, one thing has been left out, and I thought I might just draw attention to it, particularly for some of the younger people here who are contemplating a career in global health. And there, sometimes people come and ask me for advice, oh, I want to go into WHO or the World Bank. And I noticed, Francis, that after you qualified as a doctor, you worked in the rural areas looking for cost-effective measures to make quality healthcare accessible to rural dwellers. And I think there's a message for us there. Firstly, it shows that you were years and decades ahead of your time, and I think it testifies to your values as well. And maybe that's the piece of advice that I would give to people looking to go to global health, is actually get out into the coalface and learn the realities of what it's like in the rural areas before you move to the capital. We heard this morning about Francis's period as the first executive director of the Global Health Workforce Alliance, and it's very fitting that we have the first and the final executive directors here. But I just mentioned, you phoned me in 2005, and having started in Geneva with this great new title, and you said, Rory, I do have a desk, I have a chair, and I think you said you either had a telephone or a computer. I don't think you had both. Listening to Jim this morning, I think things may be reverting that way a bit. But within a year, you had set that up to be one of an organization that really drove the whole health workforce agenda in Africa. Having retired from that and having co-chaired the Global Code drafting process with Mary Robinson, I think any reasonable person would have said, maybe it's time now to lift the foot from the throttle a bit. But you kind of make life difficult for the rest of us, because you then went into your fourth career, and you were in the air, traveling around the world as often as you ever did before. And I think it's that drive, that commitment to the global good, the public good, that really epitomizes your work and your life. I'm not going to try and predict anything you might say, but I did say I was going to give a plug to this book, which you published last year with Lord Nigel Crisp. And I think you epitomize this: African health leaders making change and claiming the future. So let us welcome Professor Francis Omaswa.
Thank you very much, Rory, for that introduction. And I don't know whether you haven't said everything that I planned to say in that very brilliant summary. I'm going to speak to you maybe the next half an hour or so, and we will. I will appreciate Ireland, and maybe let me get that out of the way straight away. That story, when I went to WHO to start GOA, it was not called GOA then, they called me special advisor to the director general. They gave me a cubicle, one of those cubicles, actually a computer and a telephone. And I went to my boss, Tim Evans, who is now at the World Bank, say, okay, where is the money for this work? He swung his chair and his back was now on me and said, no, but Francis, you have a telephone, you have a computer. What we want from you is a partnership, an alliance on health workforce. So that's what I'm waiting for. And that was the end of that conversation about money. And I started to look for friends. And of course, Ireland was one of my first friends. And, you know, with David, Wickliam here, and others, and Ruari, we got a grant from Ireland. And there were others. I don't want to list them, but Ireland was the, one of the very first ones to ensure that GWA made a beginning. And of course, also personally, as a Ugandan, Uganda has had a terrific relations with Ireland. The missionaries who introduced Christianity to Uganda and ran excellent hospitals and schools. My three daughters went to the best girls' school in Uganda, the best school in Uganda, run by Irish nuns. They are still here. They came back, but I know they are here somewhere. And also one of the best hospitals in Kampala belongs to them also. And when, after many years away from Uganda, after the wars there, I went back to Kampala. The main hospital where my work was to be carried out from was in shambles, shot up, no water, what. And I went to Sister Miriam Duggan, who was the head of that hospital, almost with tears in my eyes. I want somewhere to work. Say, oh, come and work here. Without that, maybe I would have gone away from Kampala. So I have personally a lot of connections with this place. And of course, you heard Nicola today. We worked very well with her in Uganda, and so on and so on. So Ireland, when I went to get my visa, oh, they said, you've come home at the Irish embassy. And they gave me a visa without any problem at all. So it's great to be back here. And also when I was in the Ministry of Health in Uganda, I made several trips here to discuss ways in which Ireland, Irish aid, that's what it was called then. Has it changed the name? Yeah. Okay, right. So it's great to be back here. So many things, anyway. So I will also go through with you briefly why are we doing all this? And we'll talk about health. What is health? You know, with SDGs, we need to go back to understanding what our job really is as health people, ownership and leadership. So that's what we will go through in the next few minutes. So I also will this is what I do now, the African Center for Global Health and Social Transformation. It is impossible to retire. You just change jobs, isn't it? I don't know. Those of you, when you reach my age, you'll find the numbers have arrived, but you still feel the same. And in Africa, also the needs are so big. No one will let you just put your feet up and say, I'm looking after chickens and cows. It's, you know, they will always give you work. You're always turning down things and doing those which you can do. So it's not retirement. It's just you continue from one type of activity to another, hopefully making a contribution. So this is what I'm doing now. And you've read those. This really is born out of experience, and what we are trying to do above all is to build a capacity and synergies and to get Africa to contribute better and benefit more from international health, focusing on health systems, governance and leadership, and health workforce. So what is this about? Why are we doing this? You know, we human beings, we are social beings. Someone gets knocked, you see them through the window, a car or something like that, you say, oh, what a pity. You don't know the person. So by and large, our nature is we are social. We support each other more than we push down each other. And it is a pity that today, with so much knowledge, with so many resources, there are still so many people who live in poverty, people who don't have access to basic health care, and yet we are all here. So it's really about human dignity, social justice. Many times in our part of the world, there a child dies, they say God has called that child. A woman dies in labor, they say her day has come. But of course it's not like that. It's we who are there in the funeral saying those things, who could have stopped those people from dying. So that's what we really are trying to change. That's the name of our game. And it is to create a climate of opinion within our communities, in our countries, and global, which will make that possible. And it's going to be a lot of work, particularly to get all the people, as the SDGs say, to live in dignity and having the right standard of life. And it's going to take a movement similar to those which abolished slavery, colonialism. It's going to be hard work, but it is possible. So let's just go talk about health. What is health? You all know this. So this is the definition of health according to WHO. I will not spend very much time on this. The point I would like to make here is that it is about well-being. It's not about not being ill, but it is about feeling well and having the necessities of life. So both the definitions from WHO and the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, people are entitled to all this, including food, clothing, security, medical care, and I think somewhere medical care is just on the list. But more, by and large, we have taken health to be about medical care. But that is really not what health is about. It's about people living well and in peace. When I was Director General in the government of Uganda, several times a day, I had this recorded in my own voice. You know, health is made at home and only repaired in health facilities when it breaks down. And then you can read the rest. Maybe 3-4 times a day, the various radio stations would read this. And the message to the population then said, this is the message from the Director General. And the message was everyone living in their homes should be thinking about, am I taking good care of myself and my family? What are we eating today? You know, those things like don't share accommodation with animals. People actually do for various reasons. So that is, and of course all this has been borne out, the report on the social determinants of health. And here is an important message. About 6% come to the world with maybe some congenital malformations and so on, but the majority of us are born well. And the body is designed, it takes good care of itself, very wise, wiser than any one of us. So our job is to make sure that we maintain that inborn physiological system for people to keep well. And we tend to forget this. And instead, we think more about preventing disease, about treating those who are ill, but not about promoting health. And the sustainable development goals, the social determinants of health, they are taking us to this direction. And a surgeon is talking like that, it should be another person, or maybe another health promoter or something like that, but this is our responsibility, all of us. So individuals, each one of us, we have really primary responsibility to take care of our own health and the health of our families. Just basic things you sometimes have to talk about. Do you, you have a bath? Some communities you have to have that discussion with them, but it's taken for granted. They may have issues with water, but still it is something they need to be aware of. And then the health system comes in to provide that which the individual cannot do by themselves. Awareness, knowledge, and so on, laws, regulations, how to live together in community. And then our governments have a responsibility to ensure these others. Is there clean water? What is the food policies? Housing? Are people educated? And so on. And this is what I have already said. Because of pressures, you know, child is convulsing from malaria, maybe you have to deal with that. It's an obstructed labor, you have to deal with that. So the drama of that is really what has now been seen as the work of the health sector, the work of health workers. But we would like to do that, but also to concentrate on creating health, on promoting health. And we, as surgeons, I was talking to my newly found friend. He's got the office of the surgeon in WHO. That's a huge achievement. So if we are going to be heard as surgeons, we need also to be heard leading, for example, injuries. Where are surgeons in preventing injuries? If we are seen to be talking about how to design cars, how to make roads, how to, because we are sometimes the very first ones to realize that this problem is big and is there. So social accountability for all of us is an issue. But the health which we want to produce through the Sustainable Development Goals, through Alma Ata, through what is the one which I have been talking about. So I don't know if I have convinced you, but the message there is that even as clinicians, we ought to be interested and be leaders in advocating for ways which keep people healthy. And if we are seen to be doing that, our legitimacy will be stronger. And it's also, I think, our responsibility as socially accountable citizens of the world. So now I turn now to talk about Africa and leadership and so on. This will be the beginning of it. And leadership for what? Leadership for getting a healthier world. This is the Africa in which I have lived, moving towards independence after independence, very, very hopeful, very hopeful. And we achieved a lot at that time. And then problems came. Problems came. I don't know what triggered it all, but probably it could be the Cold War with our independence, and our leaders didn't really take so much care of us, and no one also cared to call them to order. You know, if you treat your people badly, as long as you voted the right way at the UN, that was okay. And if you upset the Americans, you go to the Soviet Union. If you upset those, you go to the West. And Africa got into a state when it really, the economies were so bad. Other things too, the price of oil, commodity prices fell, and so on. And we went through a stage when we actually became beggars, quite literally. And when we were in this phase, you, the good people, came and gave us some help, but also told us, you know, if you take this money, could you do this with it? Sometimes they say, please do this with it, or most of the time they said, you must do this with it, or we take away the money. And because of that, we got the people who I saw leading the Uganda health system when I became a civil servant in 1970, were Ugandans, very self-assured people. And there were also no donors at that time in Uganda. Oh, I didn't feel them at that time. But today's African leaders, many of us, you know, because of this period of beggarhood, learn, you know, getting used to be told what to do by others, there are not so many of us who, you know, a problem is here, let's solve it, I'm going to be the one to lead to solve it. And I will tell you later how even our communities are now asking for sitting allowance to solve their own problems. Anyway, that time came, and I think it is passing, not quite past yet. Things are better now. Africa, things are better now, much better. Much better, but we are still at the bottom of the development pile. This is disease burden. Africa is at the top in maternal deaths, in under five mortality, in HIV, of course, that's ours. We're better than Asia in food. So things are still bad, despite the promise. And this is core. Who cares? Does anybody care? And sometimes you see things happening in your communities where you work, even in our hospitals, and quite literally, you know, nobody seems to care. And this is actually taken from a study, Uganda Participatory Poverty Assessment Study of 2000. This is what the rural people said about themselves when they became ill. And this is a message which I try to share widely with my African colleagues. Amelia, here you've heard this already from me and others. We need to feel bad about our situation. Only then will we be able to fold up our sleeves and say, never again, let's change this. But we've got used somehow to living with wrong things, normally. And you get into that mood, it doesn't matter. So this one has failed, let's go and try another one, and so on. And that is something which is an issue which we need to deal with. So this is Africa Rising, that's the Economist magazine. 2000, their heading was Hopeless Africa. 2011, Africa is rising. And it is true that out of the 8 or 10 fastest growing economies in Africa, in the world, 10 of them are in Africa. Things are looking better in Africa. More stability because African Union, a number of reasons, two main reasons. One, the African Union, emerging from the OAU, does not tolerate illegitimate governments. So that in itself has kept away those dictators who would come, sit there, and do what they like with the people. Then also there is a strong global movement on social justice and equity. So if you treat your people badly, you end up in The Hague. I think some presidents are over there. So between those two, there is more stability in Africa and more economic growth. And this is under five mortality decline, very sharp. These are some of the good things happening in Africa. Very many good things happening in Africa. But we still have a lot to do. And this is our message, let's grasp this opportunity and let's not go back again to the problems of the past. And my own organization, this is some of the work we are doing. I have these two books here. I brought this for the Royal College of Surgeons in case you don't have. So this is a study which we did together with the New York Academy of Medicine with a grant from Rockefeller Foundation. It's about getting things right in Africa again. The ministers of health whom we interviewed at that time, it was a global study, told us they want a book. When my name is on the radio, Omaswa, you are the head minister of health, and I know nothing about health, they asked for something they can read quickly without even other people knowing that they are reading anything. So we have published a handbook for health ministers, and I will be handing this over to you. And then, of course, you've seen that African Health Leaders book shown by Ruari. And we also do every month a blog on our, there's a list ASH government blogs, and they are published in the Africa Health Journal also, discussing current affairs about what is happening in Africa and the world. So that's how we are trying to contribute to the new mindset. So in this strong ministry's report, this is how we see the situation, which has potential to get things right. So there is global, there is regional, and here is the Minister of Health. It was mainly focusing on strengthening governance of health systems. And other ministries, president, parliament, and parastatals. But this is a very important group here. These are institutions outside government, but inside the country, with the potential to support their governments. The universities are here, think tanks, professional associations, academies, research institutions, donors are also here, and civil society organizations. So the thesis in this report and its recommendation is that every country should find a way of strengthening these institutions as well as their governments. And governments are important. You know, Irish Aid works with governments. Other donors, if they are here, work with governments. But supporting the leadership of governments has not been a favorite of donors. They will give you money maybe to buy drugs. They will give you money to even human resources. They were not interested in that as well. But supporting governments, holding governments accountable, is very, very important. Without a strong government in any country, it is not possible for civil society alone to change things. So we need to find ways of working closely with governments and supporting governments. But of course, you've already heard me say governments alone are not enough. So those in the oval, we did studies in five countries in Africa. Where are those institutions which are outside the governments which can support them? They are there. They are there in every country. This is for Kenya and Uganda, but we also did Tanzania, we did Malawi, we did Mali in West Africa. These institutions are there. Then we brought them together, these institutions and their governments, to a meeting in Kampala from those five countries. We say, can you work together? And the response was overwhelming, yes. And this happens in developed countries quite a lot. But in Africa, you still find, if I'm in the Ministry of Health, I keep the others out. And if I am outside the ministry, particularly some of the people in academia, universities, and so on, they have contempt. They despise those civil servants in the Ministry of Health and so on. And then they are fighting instead of working together. So our advocacy is about getting them to work together. So these are interviewing ministers. This is what they said about the importance of professional associations. And this is important. So Africa, African Union, I told you it doesn't tolerate illegitimate governments. But they have also done a lot of work, particularly President Obasanjo when he was president of Nigeria. He convened summits, I think the first one on malaria. And then the big one on HIV and infectious diseases, which brought about the 15% contribution to health. And there is now an African health strategy. It's being revised. And there are meetings of ministers. And WHO is also very much there in Africa. And there are regional communities. These are very important. East, Central, and Southern Africa, West African Health Organization, SADC. And of course, we have professional associations. So the structures for moving forward actually do exist. The international community is also looking at us in a more positive and supportive way. This is Obama when he came to Africa for the first time. The future of Africa is up to Africans. The Blair Commission, its main message was to understand Africa better and to listen more to Africans instead of telling them what to do with your money. Ask them what they can do, or what you can do together with your money. And I got to know Lord Nigel Crisp,
when he left the National Health Service in the UK, he was asked by Tony Blair then to do a study on what the UK National Health Service could do for developing countries. That's when he was brought to me to interview me. And then I've had some working relation with him. And out of that, he wrote this book called Turning the World Upside Down. And we learn from each other. It is co-development. And you know, it can't be one way. There are so many good things which happen in the South, which you people can learn from. And it's not, I think, a problem here in Ireland. But I can tell you, in some of the countries of this world, this is an issue. They are still grappling with attitudes of people who want to tell you what you do and who don't want to do things together with you. And even those declarations, Paris and so on, and Montreal, Rome, a lot of them remain on paper. The action is different from what is declared. And so we also, Africans, it's true, we are also trying to catch up, reclaiming this can-do attitudes. There are countries in Africa, I always find it important. I know them, but I don't name them in the public because I will get into trouble with others, not the ones whom I have congratulated. So there are countries who have reclaimed their can-do attitudes in Africa, and they are moving forward. They are the ones who achieved the MDGs, or as close to them as possible, and they are showing accountability to their people. But sometimes they are also criticized for being too tough on their people, also by the North, you know, you are too tough on your people. But what's wrong with that? What is wrong with getting people all to do what they are supposed to do? So I urge you to leave these people alone, let them get on and solve their problems. So pursuing excellence and, of course, partnership. This group here, these are Africans like me and these colleagues who are here. Very well-educated people, very capable people, understand almost, well, someone said, if you think you know the solution, then you don't know the problem. But they are capable Africans who are just sitting there and not contributing, sitting with wrong things and living with them normally, and not saying, come on, this has to stop. And this came about during the bad days. If you live in a country like I did with Idi Amin, you know, if you oppose the government, you just disappear. So you learn to live with bad things. But that time has changed. There are very few governments in Africa now where people disappear. So it is time for us, as techno professionals in Africa, to speak out, to be sort of the leaders that our people expect us to be. And of course, be partnership with the rest of the world. I will come back to this later. So how do we do that? This is from Professor Panawase from Thailand. That's where I saw this slide for the first time when I was working in Goa. Thai is some of my favorite friends. So what it's saying is the triangle that moves the mountain. This is dark. This is knowledge generation there. And this is where the techno-professionals are, the universities, the academia, the Royal Colleges of Surgeons, COSEXA. That's where we are. And here is, they have written there social mobilization, but this is about society, about community, about people. So the message is that if we, who are capable of generating knowledge, work closely with our communities, with our populations, to look for solutions to their issues, to their problems, and between these two, politicians would then just be rubber stamps. Because you would go to the politicians together with the population and say, these are our issues, these are the solutions, would you please do them? If you don't, no votes. And this is what we should be working to do, to create these triangles that move mountains. And ownership is very important indeed. Ownership. So if you live normally with a problem, then I think you don't own the problem. It's not yours. It's not your responsibility. But ownership, it is from inside. It's not just someone tells you do this. You will do it if they give you money to do it. When the money goes, you go and do something else. So it is very important that we convince our communities through evidence that these are the issues. And I have talked about this already, displacement of our can-do attitude. And this is important. Those of you who work with African communities, and I do, when you take a new idea to a community and say, let's have a meeting, somewhere along the way, mainly because of using donor money, you would call people to a meeting. When they are leaving, you give them sitting allowance. You say, this is transport refund. And this has now persisted and has become a big issue. This ownership of the issues is no longer with those who are affected, but it's with those who are bringing the solution. Because you are coming to solve the solution with your own money, not their money. And the communities expect that they should be paid to solve their own problems. I know this happens to me. I am familiar with this. But I have asked colleagues around the continent also. This is real. And it is a big hindrance to development. So this is also taken from a study in Uganda, the same as the one, does anyone care? And the people were asked, rural people, what is the cause of your poverty? And 67% of them said it is health. And then again, now that you are poor, sorry, what is likely to happen to you? Again, most of them say, my health is going to go, I'm going to die. And 2 days ago, I was in Geneva in the Global Health Forum there, and the head of Red Cross, International Red Cross, was saying, in these displaced camps, millions of displaced people in the Middle East, their biggest cry is for health services. So health is important to everyone, and certainly the people too. So it should not be very hard to take this forward. And we have to find ways of holding ourselves accountable, holding governments accountable. And these are some of the ways in which this can be done, making sure that we are monitoring what is happening. And then analysis, that's where we need the universities, we need the COSEXAs, we need the think tanks. And then from this analysis, we also need to find where the solutions are. And this should be applied at all levels. So what big challenge we have is having correct information, having data, having ways in which we carry out studies and share these studies with our societies, with our government, and particularly with the government, inform and inspire, not name and shame. This also is very important. Our governments are very sensitive, very sensitive. You criticize a political leader in the open, that's the last time they will hear you again. But if you go to them, say, sir, I have this information, what do you think? And you haven't embarrassed them in any way, they will come around and even claim that they are the ones who have found that solution and implement it. And you keep quiet. Only a few people know that you are the one who has told them. And then they will come to you again. This is the way I prefer to operate, and I find it works. So, I have said this already. We need to have in every country a critical mass of individuals and institutions that are keeping the health agenda permanently visible, and of course also finding solutions and marketing those solutions in acceptable ways. So we talk about leadership from this report. These are the definitions in this report about leadership and stewardship, governance, leadership, and so on. And I don't think we should bother very much going into this. We all know what leadership is about. It's really about getting other people to do those things which you believe need to be done. And also doing it, not seeing a problem and watching it, but actually saying this needs to be corrected. I fold up my sleeves and get on with it. It's easier to walk away from it, but that is not leadership. And that is what we want to see more of in Africa. So this is another study we did for the USAID in Uganda. It said we've put in so much money. I think you were referring to it, Jim. We put in so much money into leadership and capacity building here in Uganda. Where are the results? And this is it. So taking people to management institutions, and they teach them from textbooks what is management about, as is maybe taught in Harvard. Or, by the way, I have a certificate from the Irish Management Institute. Some years ago, we were sent here for training in corporate governance, and I am very proud of that certificate. It's helping me a lot. So this is taken from Makerere Business School. And they say we teach people here when they come, when they go back to the civil service, what we teach them doesn't apply. Because they don't teach them how to deal with things like nepotism, things like corruption. They are not open enough to them. They are teaching them from textbooks, which they have also read. But context, where is my friend from Ghana? Ah, there he is. We were having lunch, and we were talking about context. Context is everything. You have to contextualize the issues and then localize the solutions, and you are then able to do. Just having knowledge alone is not enough. This is the same. You need to be able to analyze and understand what is it. Why is this not working? And until you do that, then you probably will give up, walk away, and you will not be able to get your results. So moving forward. So it is building capacity and synergies. That's that is our motto, the Archest motto. So building capacity is easier to build from institutions that already exist. And which is contextualized. And there are local institutions to grow from. Sometimes they say set up a new institution. When I was in Goa, one of the consulting firms, we were preparing one of those Goa papers. And the consultant firm said, set up a new organization in Africa to deal with this HRH problem. Then I said, we have them already. I gave you that list already, XR, WAHO, and so on. They said, you need to do that. So I told them to leave. And that was a big star. Say, what is happening? You can't leave. Anyway, eventually. So it is easier to build on what is there than to make a beginning with new things. COSEXA, I will talk about that in a moment, was born from ASEA and so on. And these are the issues: locally driven research, contextualization, management and leadership, sharing information. The implementation gap is huge. And of course, monitoring and evaluation. This is standard stuff. So let's talk about the surgeons and COSEXA. And so those are the COSEXA countries. COSEXA is the daughter of ASEA, Association of Surgeons of East Africa. And these are great people, the people who started this Association of Surgeons of East Africa. They believed in Africa. They believed in Africans. And they formed a very solid social network. With Dennis Robson here, which each year we would come. He comes with his Scottish kilt, and there are also other Scotsmen at home, the Caswells, they come with kilts. We have a scientific meeting, but we also dance. and we put each other up in each other's houses where we go, and we built a very, very strong bond. And my own life has been tremendously influenced by this group. I would not have become a surgeon if it were not for this group. And everything else which I have done has been influenced by them. And not just me, many others. So I'm sure this is with the Royal College of Surgeons. You can probably teach us this more, but this is the foundation of COSEXA. And people are willing to sacrifice, put in their own money, driving this ASEA to become COSEXA was not easy. But it was supported by the community spirit, which was already strong. What we found, I came from Liverpool. I went to Nairobi to work there, of course, taken by the surgeons. They came to my house in Liverpool, said, don't stay here, let's go to Nairobi. And they started taking me around Malawi, Zambia, Mozambique. And it was already very clear that training the surgeons in Mulago Hospital in Kampala, Kenyatta in Nairobi, UTH in Zambia, we were not going to get the type of surgeons that we wanted. But by that time, I'd worked in a small hospital where these surgeons took me in Ngora in Uganda. And I thought, oh, we were training interns. They are much better than they were being trained in the national hospitals. So why don't we open this thing up so that you can train surgeons wherever there are surgeons who can train? So to persuade ourselves on that was an issue, because there are others of us who thought, let's train family doctors. They called it tropical surgeon. But anyway, eventually we decided that these people must be equal to those who were getting Master of Medicine. And it took also some time to convince the government in the regions. And fortunately, by that time, I was now very much connected with the Ministry of Health in Uganda. I was not yet Director General, but I was connected with them as Chief Surgeon. I attended all the meetings of the ministers and so on. And it was possible to negotiate for the college to become recognized by the government. And it took 10 years to do that. And it is, and now we have other colleges have joined us. Anesthesiologists, I think you are supporting them from Ireland, ophthalmology. Pathologists are all open. The physicians, internal medicine people are launching in July. So, you know, this is something which is growing. It's a success, and it is attributed to the leadership of the surgeons. And it is these ASEA surgeons who started the MMed programs. They are also the ones who were actually leading the development of surgical services in the whole region. They were a great group of people. I can say a lot more about them. So these are some of my adventures in Africa in leadership. I left Nairobi with my wife. She's an anesthesiologist. The surgeons, Sir Ian McAdam, were you in that meeting, Dennis, in Mombasa? Said, let's go and test these ideas in some place far away from the center. And I told them, if you take it to that place, I'll go and do it for you. So we left Nairobi and went there. Things were going, you know, it was a very bad time for Uganda. This was now beginning of the 80s. Each time we tried to do something, it went wrong, and the people laughed. Say, but why are you laughing at this? Oh, but this is Uganda. What do you expect? They were used to things going wrong. And I wondered, what mistake have I made to come to a place where people laugh when things go wrong? Say, okay. Then I started thinking about this, and then I started telling them, let's change this place so that when things go wrong here, we are surprised and annoyed. And slowly, again, with the help of the surgeons, where is Dr. Walker? Mr. Walker is somewhere here. He came to visit me. He's over there. He came to visit me in that lonely place. Of course, Dennis Robson came many times to visit me in that place. And within just 2 years, we transformed that hospital into one of the most highly efficient small hospitals, 120 beds it was. We transformed it into one of the most efficient hospitals. Benchmarks, if you come with the ruptured ectopic in your arriving casualty, within 20-30 minutes an incision has already been made to deal with you. And we were able to do that, and so many people wanted to come and work there. And later, when I was Director General in the Ministry of Health, a new president of the African Union Commission was appointed, Honorable Alpha Konare from Mali. So he convened advisors, and I was the one who was invited to speak on health. And this was the theme of my talk there. This is a new Africa of the 21st century. What do you expect? Only the best. After my talk, everybody stood up and clapped for a very long time, and I've taken interest in using this from that time onwards. So this is possible. You know, Africa needs to get a mindset where only the best is accepted. Some friends tell me I'm aiming too high, but if you don't aim high, you won't go far. So this may never happen, but who knows, it may happen also. But that is our goal, that's our vision, that's our mission, to get that right. Uganda Heart Institute in Kampala, Mulago Hospital, they were laughing at me and saying, that can't work. A heart institute here in a place which didn't have water, electricity, water, no money, but it is there now. It's alive and kicking just because one is able to persist with it. A Global Fund was a very big experience for us. The first chair of the Global Fund board was the Minister of Health from Uganda, and we were very instrumental in creating the Global Fund. The big lesson for me here was that we Africans were very weak in negotiating. Very, very weak. America would bring a delegation maybe of 20 people to one meeting, and we would go to from Uganda, the minister and myself. And then also they came very prepared for the discussions. We didn't come prepared for the discussions. And the number of things they were pushing down on us, but that is it. And it's one of the reasons why I created ACHEST, to get evidence so that when Africans go to meetings, at least they have also got some information they come on. And we took part in negotiating the Paris Declaration. I don't need to say any more about GWA, but GWA, I hope it will not die completely. Okay. So, I just put this slide on. Until Nicola came, I wasn't going to speak about this. But the message here is that at the end of the day, you need strong governments. You need strong governments which are able to coordinate donors. Donors also are looking for strong leaders. They work easier if they have good counterparts to work. Openness also, mutual respect, ownership. We got district leaders to own planning for their services, and the results were good. Strong country leadership. And you need a critical mass of individuals inside the system. I said this already. And trust, openness, mutual respect, all this. That's what we did in Uganda. And the results were very encouraging. In a period of about 3 to 5 years, utilization of health facilities shot up. We exceeded the targets, immunization coverage, and so on. And all that was the Minister of Health, whom we had there. He's also the person who was the chairman of the Global Fund Board, was a great guy. He worked very, very hard. Meetings up to 2 a.m., 4 a.m., and so on, and I was privileged to be his director general. So that's this book, African Health Leaders, What Is It About? And this is the last slide, if give you some relief. What do we as Africans do want to do more for ourselves? The book has got about 14 stories of things which Africans have implemented themselves in their own countries. Mozambique, Portuguese went away and left the place without any doctor. So the then Minister of Health in Mozambique trained nurses and other clinical officers to do essential surgery, including cesarean sections. It worked. It is working now. More countries are adopting it. It's a big adventure. It's a story from Gambia on river blindness, and how with the dedication, a Nigerian doctor who was married in the Gambia was able to bring down river blindness and spread that message to the whole of Africa. Uganda, when Peter Mugenye, he started an HIV clinic there, the Americans, someone called Andrew Noshes, actually the head of USAID, said in 2001, Africans can't take ARVs. You know, they tell the time by the sun. So when you tell him, take it at 10 a.m., does he know what 10 a.m. is? But this Peter Mugenye said, yes, I can show you that Africans can be very diligent consumers of the ARVs. And his story is in that book, and so on and so on. There are many other stories there. So, but we need to do more for ourselves than we are doing now, not to live normally with problems. And then what do we expect from the rest of the world in the spirit of global solidarity? From the rest of the world, I think we expect partnership. And we expect to learn jointly from each other. We learn from you, you learn from us. And if we need your money, it is because the money, when it comes to us, also helps you. Ebola in Uganda is Ebola in anywhere in the world. So let's have ways of global solidarity. And the vision is that one, the message which I started with. It is about promoting wellness of people, not about preventing disease and treating disease. Yes, we have to treat disease, we have to prevent disease, but let's work to create a climate where people make health in their own homes and where health promotion is part and parcel of our work, all of us. And of course for everyone. And quality is affordable, well, you know, for everybody. With the resources that you have, you can do much more than what you probably think you are doing. And our mission is, this is Africa, what do you expect? Only the best. So if we aim high, we will get there with your help. Thank you very much indeed.